of engineering and technology. So the agenda what we are going to cover in this session is why we require MongoDB, what is MongoDB, and what is the difference we have with SQL and MongoDB, and the basic CRUD operations in MongoDB. CRUD here refers to create, read, update, and delete operations. So why MongoDB? Why not SQL? So I hope you are all familiar with big data. Big data is the data what we have in large volume, various varieties or properties, and the instant of data what we get in with each database will be in a higher speed. So these three V's, that is velocity, volume, and variety, refers to the terminology of big data. Apart from these three, we have more V's added, but mainly when we concentrate with big data, we focus on these three V's, that is volume, velocity, and variety. So when you consider volume, our traditional databases, what we have, say for example, we have SQL, we have RDBMS kind of databases. So the traditional databases what we use now will not be able to handle this big data with respect to volume. Volume, huge voluminous data will not be able to fit in a particular relational databases. Similarly, when we come with the variety, you cannot predict the data type of data what you get in from your social network or Twitter or any other kind of common websites. So big data you mainly use with respect to the irrespective of the data types. So to handle the big data what you have, you require some sort of procedure to maintain the data type what you get in. For a fraction of a second you will be getting, say for example, I am going to take WhatsApp based information. So at an instant I may get a text message, at an instant I may get an audio file or video file or a GIF file, whatever be the kind you have. So in a single moment or in a single second, we cannot predict what is the data I am going to get. And with that data, you cannot have the standard way of having all the processing functionalities in a traditional manner. So with this big data, how I am going to manage the normal querying operation, and rather how to go it with the data analytics portion. So all these things will be troublesome when you compare, when you get in with the normal SQL or normal relational databases. So in big data analytics, that is whenever you want to handle the big data or whenever you want to handle the analytical oriented operations with respect to big data, we have to form a framework wherein I have to store the data which is of higher volume, which is of different variety, and which is of higher velocity. So with these three V's in concern, we are getting into with the data and the storage mechanism for that, and finally we will be doing the analytical operations, right? So whenever you go with the normal storage mechanism for big data, we have the concept of NoSQL databases. So NoSQL stands for not only SQL. So this is mainly used as a platform to store the data what you have for big data analytics. So I hope you may be familiar with NoSQL, or just an introduction to NoSQL databases. You have different types of NoSQL databases: graph database, columnar database, your document-oriented database, and simple key-value database pairs, right? So with this NoSQL in hand, we are going to move with our big data analytics. And you have the scalability measure with big data. the data. It is in huge volumes, and I will be difficult to scale it into millions and millions of data. So scalability forms the main issue wherein you handle your big data. And also your data will be from distributed environment. You may have your data split into various tables, and you may have that into multiple databases, multiple tables. So the data stored in different variety and in different distributed environment will not be collected together and processed in case of your normal SQL, right? So scalability plays a main role whenever you go with the normal SQL database processes. Next is your flexibility. As I said earlier, our big data is of complex structure. Complex in the sense, it is of different variety or different data type. You have millions and millions of variety for handling your big data, and you cannot have the fixed data structure to store that kind of varietyous data, right? So normally whenever we consider our RDBMS or SQL based platforms, your data will be stored in a fixed table. You may remember that each table will have a field, and for each field you have rows inserted. You have a specific fixed data structure, and that data structure, whenever you have defined already, you will not be able to modify unless otherwise you get in with some important commands, right? So whereas this SQL, what we use for fixed data structure, will not be compatible with the big data. Why I am saying this is, big data, as you all know, it is with different variety. It is with different data type. One may be with audio file, one may be with video file, one may be a plain text message, or just a phone number, in the sense of just a number, collection of digits. So in these different categories, you will have the data storage. And I don't know under what size I am going to maintain my data, under what type I am going to get my data. So with these concerns in mind, we cannot take the flexibility of fixing that into a particular data structure. So whenever you get in with the SQL databases, you have a rigid structure, and that data structure has to get in with the fixed type of data storage. So when you have big data in hand, this fixed data structure will not be easier for us, and it will not be easy for modifications to that data structure also. And before getting into the creation of my database in SQL, I have to spend many time in analyzing and in creating or designing that database. This is with respect to your normal SQL. So for SQL databases, you will have to have timing in designing and development of database before considering with the normal operations. So that design involves how many columns I have to get in with, what is the limit for each column, what is the data type of each and every column I am using. So all these you have to consider with respect to your normal SQL. But this cannot be the case with MongoDB or the normal big data what you have. Okay, so also you have the constant restructuring of the objects. So whenever you get in with agile projects, you know agile is ad hoc development of projects, right? So in software development, whenever the customer requirement is coming ad hoc, your normal way of creating a software or developing a software will not be suited. So in that case, we will go for agile project development. So even in agile project development, you have constant restructuring of the databases. So if you have a fixed type of restructuring, so even for that, you will not have the flexibility. So you cannot use the normal SQL for big data to store your voluminous and variety of data. So next is your performance. So what about the performance? We know that big data is of huge volume. It is of TBs and MBs high. So whenever you have a query to be updated or a query to be given for a database with respect to big data, you need to join with multiple tables which is residing under a distributed environment, and that will have a very high impact on performance. So all these measures are with respect to the traditional SQL databases what you handle. So with SQL, you will not be able to have joining with multiple tables. Whenever you increase the tables, you may have an impact over the performance. And moreover, you also have the caching mechanism, and that will also be very difficult in order to get faster performance. So with these three considerations, that is scalability, flexibility, and performance, you will not be able to have the traditional SQL-based data structure for storing your big data. So this is the performance chart what we have for MongoDB and SQL. So you see left hand, I mean in the y-axis you have seconds, and in the x-axis you have how many rows I am going to insert. So in MongoDB, the time used for each and every insert operation is very, very minimum when compared with the SQL insertion, right? So from this performance chart itself, we may get an idea that for handling big data, you have a database that is not with traditional SQL. Okay, so with this introduction, let us get into with NoSQL databases. So MongoDB, as I have told you already, it is a kind of NoSQL database, and you have different variety of NoSQL types. So first one is your key value pair, where you will have within parenthesis the key, that is for example, if I have to store a name, you may write that as a name, comma value for that name, example Tom, Raj, anything you can have. Similarly, second attribute, if I'm going to store age, I'm having age comma 25. What is the value I am going to assign for age? So when I store this as key comma value within brackets, you have that database to be key value pair, and the databases which suits to this category will be your DynamoDB, Azure table, which is frequently called as ATS. So all these are NoSQL key value pair databases. Then the second category will be your document based data. So document, in the sense you will have everything as the list specified within curly brackets. So you have all the collection of keys and values within curly brackets, and each will be denoted or saved as a document. So very good examples for document oriented databases will be your MongoDB, Amazon Simple, and CouchDB. So all these will come under document oriented database. Next one is your graph database. So in the case of a graph database, you will have different nodes where you have the keys, and followed by that you have a child node to represent the values. So for courses you have a masters and location, and for student you have a specific course allotted. Then student will be named by a name and an age, right? So in this way, if I represent that as node followed by links, you have a graph database. And the database which use of this type will be your Neo4j and InfoGrid. These are the example for graph type database or graph type NoSQL databases. Then the next one is your column oriented database, where you have HBase, a very basic or very normal thing what you have for your Hadoop environment. So in Google Bigtable or HBase, that uses column oriented databases where you will have row IDs mentioned as 1, 2, 3 or identifiers to identify each and every row, followed by the columns will have the each and every key value pair values. Okay, so that will be with respect to your column oriented databases. So these are the different kinds of NoSQL databases what we use in our analytic purpose, for mainly for big data, right? And as I told you, your MongoDB will be coming under the document-based NoSQL data type. So coming to why MongoDB and what are its features. So MongoDB is almost used 80 to 90% in enterprise organizations as a big data processing database tool. The features of MongoDB, as it is told, it is a document-oriented NoSQL database, and you don't have specific type structure. You may not enforce, or you will not have any enforcement or fixing of format for this particular MongoDB. And the main advantage over MongoDB is all the execution or all the data, what you store there will be in the form of JSON. JSON is nothing but your JavaScript object notation, and that will be interoperating with it with all kind of applications. So it is server-side JavaScript, and you represent everything as JSON objects, right? And also MongoDB has the flexibility in offering the load balancing between multiple servers. So if this is capable, you may have higher performance with respect to the processing of big data, right? And mainly it works on the concept of collections and documents, and we will see to the terms of collections and documents when we get in with the normal operations of MongoDB commands, right? So the keywords what we speak with the MongoDB will be collections and documents. So what is JSON? JSON is nothing but your JavaScript object notation. Why we get in with the JSON object? Because it is human readable format. We will represent all the objects in real world entity. We will try to map everything in real world entity, and so that it will be easy for the customer and also for the programmer or developer to understand and emphasize everything as an application, right? So it is easy for humans to read and also to programmers to parse each and every the notation. So we go for JSON, and the flexibility here is you can have objects to be nested, and mainly it is built upon the name value or key value pairs, right? And that values will be in an ordered list. So MongoDB stores everything as binary JSON. It is encoded in a binary format, and that will be similar to your documents. So this allows MongoDB for referencing all the documents easily. Indexing is also possible. Then you also have embedded structures to reduce the need for joins, as joins take more time in case of your normal SQL, and it affects your performance. That gets reduced whenever you go for reference-oriented operations, what you have with respect to your BSON, that is binary JavaScript object notation. So the main goals of using BSON will be, it is lightweight, you can traverse very easily, and the encoding and decoding process will be efficient. Okay, so all these features will be shared by MongoDB, and that's why we have MongoDB in hand, used for all kind of big data processing, that is storing big data and processing over that. And this is an example for BSON, where you have everything as a document, and you have key followed by value. Key will be your city, what you have it in the left hand side, colon, right hand side will be your value. And you will also have nested structures. So you can nest for all the documents or the attributes what you have it. And the main thing what you will have to concentrate here is each and every document what you store in your MongoDB will be prefixed by underscore ID as with respect to your auto ID in case of normal SQL. So you have the auto ID generation for normal SQL databases or Oracle databases that denotes for automatic primary key identification. If you have not defined any primary key, Auto ID will enable that feature, right? So similarly, for each MongoDB document, you have underscore ID to be automatically enhancing with the primary key of that particular document. So this is the by default ID will be added for the each document, and it serves as the primary key value for that, and that key value will be unique, immutable, and it will not be non-array type. Okay, so primary key we all know that is used for unique identification, and you will have that to be immutable, wherein you cannot change its value in between, and all this thing will be in a non-array type. So this is an example what you have for binary JSON, or in MongoDB everything will be stored in the form of this document structure. Okay, so why we are using MongoDB? Because of high amount of data, and the storage what we have is of different variety, and we have document oriented storage and cached data, and schema is unstable, so you cannot have a fixed schema in representing a particular data. You will have schema less orientation or the architecture, and for these reasons, instead of your SQL, we will be using MongoDB. And these are the terminologies which we have to look into whenever we get in with MongoDB. So in traditional SQL operations, you have or you define a database. The word database is similarly used in the case of MongoDB also. But after creating a database, we will be creating a table. We are used up in saying that as tables. But in the case of MongoDB, it is called as collection. Each and every table what you mentioned with respect to SQL will be called as collection in MongoDB. Okay, and each and every row or the record what we have will be called as document. So in a collection, you will have various documents or different number of documents, right? And the field or column what we denote for SQL goes same, that will be called as field in MongoDB also. Okay, and the join, whenever you join with tables, you perform the join operation over multiple tables, that will be called as linking or embedding of documents with respect to your MongoDB. Okay, so linking will be similar to join operation in SQL. And primary key, that will be defined by the user normally in the case of SQL databases. Whereas in the case of MongoDB, primary key will be your underscore ID field. Okay, we are going to store just the documents alone. In a collection, I will be inserting the documents. That is, I will be inserting only the rows for each and every collection. So the documents you are inserting need not be having or need not be prefixed with any primary key for indexing or for retrieval, because in MongoDB that functionality is taken over by underscore ID field, and that underscore ID field will be automatically taken by MongoDB for processing as a primary key. Okay, then for indexing, you have the similar terminology in MongoDB also, right? So this is the sample document structure, collection structure, what you have in MongoDB with respect to the table structure in SQL. So in normal table structure, you will be having at the top first row, you will be having all the column names followed by the values for each and every column. So Joe and last name, email, everything will be called as the single row. So you have two rows of records in this table, and that can be written in the collection format by adding two documents to that collection, right? Say, for example, if I name this table as employee, you can have employee to be the collection name, and Joe and Bob are two documents for that collection. So that two documents will be segregated by means of curly brackets. So first document within curly bracket, and within that you will have key, colon, value, syntax. So I am going to represent that as key, colon, value. Similarly, for the second document, you have to separate that with comma. Again, you open a curly bracket, then you have the second record or the second document inserted, wherein the same format is followed, key, colon, value. So this is the structure of MongoDB document, what you recognize with respect to your SQL table. So with this introduction, let us start with the hands-on on MongoDB installation. And this is the link where you can download your MongoDB version, EXC or MSI file. And you will have different flavors of MongoDB. The command line interface, what we call as CLI, will be available. And this community center, this URL, what I have listed in the slide, will be your community center for downloading all the flavors what you require, right? So mainly you have the thing what we are going to see in today's session will be the command line interface, just MongoDB CLI, and that will be your command line interface. You also have GUI-oriented interface for interaction graphically your MongoDB commands, and that will be with respect to your MongoDB Compass. So if you install MongoDB Compass, you may have GUI-oriented interface to practice MongoDB commands, right? So MongoDB, just you have it as a MSI file for CLI, that is command line interface. So for CLI, we are going to see in this session. Interested participants may refer with the MongoDB Compass. You can download that also for getting graphical-oriented interface for executing the commands relevant to your MongoDB. Okay. And you also have, whenever you want to have the database that should be stored as a cloud, you can download Atlas, MongoDB Atlas. So that will enable you to have cloud-oriented database functionalities, right? So these are the different flavors you have in MongoDB installation. And let us start with the demo. Let me show the next screen. And these are the operations we are going to see in that MongoDB after installation: create, read, update, and delete. We will have a hands-on over this. Okay, 1 second. So for the purpose of time constraints, I have downloaded this MongoDB already. So this is my MSI installer package that is downloaded from that website, right? So this MongoDB Windows, and make sure that it is 64. MongoDB 64-bit OS MSI package has been downloaded. And this has to be installed in your system, right? When you double click this, you can try installing with the MongoDB, and it will be only of a few seconds to install. And once if you install that, you will have a folder in your program files, MongoDB folder. Okay, so after downloading the MSI file, you can try with its installation. Once the MongoDB is installed, you will have a folder by the name MongoDB under C program files. Okay, so when you take into that, you will have a server operation, and these are the two versions and I have downloaded with 4.4. So when you get into this, you will have bin, data and log. Okay, the exe file will be under bin. Okay, so you see here you have three exe files or three application, the normal Mongo wherein you will be using that for CLI, that is command line shell prompt, and you also have MongoD, that is Mongo daemon. This will be used for background processing, okay, for making connection to your server. So this MongoDB will be acting as a background process. This is a batch file, right? And server side, you will have MongoS. Okay, so you kindly check whether after installation, you make sure that whether you have these two executable files, that is Mongo and MongoD executable files in your directory under bin. Okay, so MongoDB folder will be automatically installed, created, and that be under MongoDB, under the bin folder, you will have these two executables, that is Mongo and MongoD, right? And to start with the working operations of MongoDB through command line interface, you need to execute these two files, that is MongoD and Mongo. So Mongo will be your shell where you have all the commands to be worked with, and this MongoD will be a daemon process, that is background process, which will be connecting your database server. Okay, so before trying with the execution, you just open the command prompt. So in the command prompt, you get in with the path where you have that bin folder. So you have it under server 4, then bin. So you make sure that you are in this path, right? C program files, MongoDB server 4.4 bin. So within MongoDB, under bin, your path should be there. Then you try with MongoD command. So this refers to the daemon process. So this should be started before enabling all the command line interfaces. Okay. So you type this and press enter. And this will start. So there is no error. Initially, if you have this to be started, you will get an error in creation of data folder under C, right? I have done that already. So I am not getting any error in running this. So before running this, make sure that you have the data folder, that is under your C drive, you should have a folder by the name data, and under data you create DB as the folder. Okay, make sure this is available. If this is not there, you will get an error while running the daemon process. If you run the MongoD command, you will get an error in running that whenever you don't have this data folder. So under C, create a folder by the name data, and within data you create another folder by the name DB, right? So this is mandatory for running that batch file. Okay, so this MongoD command will be executed, and if these two are created, if these two folders are created, you will not have any issues in starting that batch file, that is MongoD command. Okay, so once if that is started, you minimize that window and you get in with another command prompt. You have the second command prompt. Since I'm unable to share entire screen, I'm switching over between share again and again. So this is the second command prompt I have opened. Okay, so this is for the normal execution of your shell commands, that is MongoDB commands. So here also you go to that folder, program files, and under that you have MongoDB server, then 4.4, there, okay. So in this, you can start with Mongo. That is the actual command what you have for practicing or initiating your Mongo database interface. Okay. So make sure before starting this, you need to run MongoD as your background process. And for that to run without any error, you require data folder under C drive. Okay. So when you click on this, you are ready with the shell prompt. Okay, so this is the command line interface what you have for your MongoDB for execution of the commands. Okay, so once this is installed, you can get in with the practice of creating a database, creating a collection, creating or inserting documents into a collection, how to read records or how to read the documents, how to update each and every document or collection. All these operations or the database commands what you have for MongoDB, you can practice in this shell prompt, that is in the command line interface of your MongoDB. Okay, so this is the basic version. This is the CLI interface what you have for the MongoDB execution as commands, as database commands. You have it as a shell prompt, right? Whenever you want to have it as a button oriented or graphical oriented boxes, you can get in with your Compass execution. Okay, when you download MongoDB Compass, you can have it in GUI oriented application, wherein you can click over the buttons to insert or to create a database or to insert documents into a collection. That will be completely with the graphical oriented interfaces. As of now, to have a basic idea of what is Mongo, what are all the requirements you have for MongoDB installation, let us have a look into the basic shell prompt or the CLI phase of Mongo. Okay, so here you can check whether what are the databases you are in, right? Defaultly you will have the database, namely test, to be your default databases. So when I type db and press enter, you have test to be the database. Okay, and you can also create the databases for your own purpose. That is, if I am going to develop a database, I can create that by typing use command. Okay, so use is the command which is used for two purposes. One is to create a new database if it is not already available. The second thing is to use the database or to switch over to that database if it is already there, right? So assume that I have to create student database. Okay, so let me type the command use student. So see the command. You have the interpreter as switched to DB student. So here DB student is created, that is database student is created. Let us check whether what are all the databases available. For that you have the command show DBS. Okay, so admin is one database, config local, and I have created a sample database already, that is also listed there, right? So this is the normal databases. And why not student is displayed here? Unless you have collections in it, you will not have that listed, right? So if you try to create a collection or try to create a table in SQL terminology, you will get the list of student also in your show database. Okay, so this is the methodology to create a database. Whenever I try with use a database name, your database will be created. Okay, then you can add in your collections. Collections are referred as tables in SQL. So you can create collections into the database what you are using. Now we are in student database. You can create the collection by having let us see what are the collections we have already. So you have a student database that is by default it is used. Then if you check with student.db. So db dot collections. So with this collections, we haven't created any collections under the name student. So I am not getting any output for this particular command. Okay. So whenever you don't have any output, you are getting the same command again. If you start with creating the collections, you will have this particular list enable like show databases. Okay, so this is the creation of database, and you also have creation of documents, creation of your collection, and how to insert documents into specific collections. So we will switch over to the PPT, then we will have the hands-on over this. So these are the operations what we are going to see: create, read, update, and delete. So these are the normal basic MongoDB commands what we have. Mongo for entering into the client, then show databases for listing of all the databases, and show database will display the database only if you have at least one collection in it, right? At least one collection you should have, or one document you should have in database. Only then you will get that displayed. And if you type only DB, the active database name will be displayed. So initially we saw that whenever I type DB, you had test to be displayed, right? And to show what is the name of a database, how many collections are in it, and what are the documents in that particular database, all the statistical information about the data, you can get in with db.stats command. Okay, and to create or to use an existing database, you can have for use followed by database name, and drop or to remove a database, you have drop database, right? So how to create collection? So collection is nothing but a table, right? In SQL, you can map it to a table. So here in MongoDB, each and every table will be called as collection. So how to create collection? The command used here is db.createCollection. So create collection will be the command, and within brackets, you will be having the name of that collection. Okay. So whenever I want to create a collection by the name student, you can have db.createCollection within brackets, you need to give student within quotes. Okay. And you also have options to be the second parameter. So second parameter will be having four different options that is given in the table. If it is denoted as cat, it tries to override the old entries, whatever available in the earlier collection. Okay, when I want index to be automated, in that case you can have auto index ID field, and you can limit the number of collections, that is the number of documents for a particular collection, size of that collection. So when you have capped equal to true, and then you can maximize, or you can set the maximum size for each collection. So that can be given by size option, and maximum number of documents that you have to insert for a particular collection also you can set. So all these four options you can have whenever you start creating a collection, right? And collection dot drop will erase the particular collection, right? So you have to give the collection name followed by dot drop method. So this will be deleting the collection or the table. So this is for creating collection. So create will have the database. To show database, you have show DBS use, and show collections will list out the collections available under that database, right? So after creating the collections, you may try with this show collection command to display what are the collections you have in that particular database. And this is to insert. So once you had created a table or collection, you can get in with the insert command. That is db.collection followed by collection, in the sense collection name followed by insert method. So in under that insert, you have field value pair. You can go with the normal entire document insert or with field value pair, or you can have insert many having number of documents to be inserted, right? So these are the commands you have for insert operation. So let me stop with this and try executing all these what we have seen so far. So as we have seen here, when I try with the show collections, you don't have anything there, right? So show collections, there is nothing in that particular database. So let us try to create a collection for this particular database. So our database name is student. Let me try to create a table or collection by the name student academic, right? Or academic. So let me try with the command db.create collection of academic. Okay, so if you have this OK command, it means that your command is successful. Your execution of the command is successful, right? So db.create collection will give you the collection academic, which is created. Now if you try with show collections, you can see academic listed, right? So under student database, you have created a table by the name academic. So table here refers to the collection. And how to get in with insert? So let me try to add the fields for this particular academic. So for that, what we have to do, we have to get in with db dot the collection name. The collection name here is academic dot insert of everything denoted as key value pair. Okay, let me assume that I have student roll number colon 101, and that should be enclosed within curly bracket. So I have a single document with a single field, okay, that is student roll number. If you want to increase the field, you can give comma. Okay, so let me have a student name colon within quotes. You can write the name of student. Say for example, I am accessing with student one. So this is a single collection with a single document, and that document has two attributes or two fields. Okay. So once if your query is okay, you will have the insertion. Right result, inserted one. One row has been inserted. That is, one document has been inserted in your collection. Okay. So if this is okay, how do we see that whether that particular value 101 and student one has been in that collection? For that, you have to use find operation. That is, db dot collection name dot find. Okay, so you see here, whenever I try with this find is similar to select query in SQL, right? So whenever I want to check whether what I have inserted has been available in the table or not, in that particular collection or not, you can get in with find operation. So here find results in the ID value, which is taken automatically by the MongoDB, followed by the value what I have given, right? So the key is role, its value 101, and the key is name, its value is student 1. So I have two fields for this particular document. This is one document. You can also add one more document by having the same command, db.academic.insert of, you can get in with role colon 102 comma name student 2. Okay, so if you can also have in this way, individual documents can be inserted by insert one, that is insert command alone. Whenever you have insert with the multiple lines, say for example, I am having the same by comma separated value. Again, I am going to give role 103 comma name student 3. Okay. So this is inserting many values. So in this case, when I want to see the details, you can get in with find command, academic dot find of. So here three values are inserted, but with same 102 student 2. So the thing here is we have not segregated with semicolon, right? So here you can insert single row by having this insert command. Insert many, if you use in this case, you can insert that under different documents. So whenever I want to insert two or three documents in a single insert command, in that case you have to use insert many option, that is insert many method. Okay, so here we are getting the same 102 twice. Okay, why that is you are used insert alone. If you have used insert many, you can get in with these two entries listed under collections. Okay, so in this way you can try with the find operation, and find also will try with selecting based on conditions, that is based on relational operators or logical operators. Say for example, I have to check whether I have to display the documents with roll number less than 200. So in that case also you can use your find command with your less than symbol, that is less than relational operators. Okay, so you can explore with the find command so that you can have where class implemented, and you also have the mixing of your relational operators and logical operators in accessing and in selecting the documents with some specific criteria. Okay, so that can be implemented with find method, right? So these denotes the collection storage and document storage for a particular database. Let us switch on to the PPT now. So as we saw already, this is db.collection insert a single document. So that will try to insert a single document. And you can also have field colon value, and insert many will try to insert more number of documents with a single insert command. Okay, so this is how you will insert documents into your MongoDB database. Next is with find operation. So this is used to retrieve the documents that we have stored already in your MongoDB collection. So to get all documents in a collection, you have the simple find method. And what is here pretty is, this is used to format, this is used to format your output. Pretty will format your output in a specific result. Okay, and find one will try to retrieve only one document which matches. Then you can also find with the field name followed by value. This will be equivalent to select where field name equal to value. So that will be find of field name with its value. So only the document which matches that value will be retrieved. You can also have multiple where conditions, wherein you can join two or more documents. So in that case, you can use the logical operator and wherein you have db.collection find of field colon value followed by and keyword operator. Then you also have two different documents, right? So you can combine different documents and then you can retrieve values. So this is similar to joining or using where class, wherein you join two or more tables in retrieving the data values. Okay. Then you can also have with this less than, greater than, in, not in, all those structures for retrieving the values. And for that, you will have in value comma value. If this value is okay, if this key value is present in your document, that particular document will be retrieved, right? So these find alone will give you the row information or the document information for a particular database or for a particular collection. Assume that I have to project a particular field from a collection. So in that case, projection command will be your db.collectionName.find of first curly brackets will be your empty bracket that will be automatically taken care for ID, that is underscore ID purpose, what you have for MongoDB. And second will be your field name. Okay, so field name comma value or colon value. So that will be created or retrieved with projection. Whenever I want to select a single field or single column, you can get in with that projection, right? So all the above commands will be having the selection of single document, whereas projection resembles the taking of one particular field from a document. Okay, so for that it is mandatory for you to give one empty curly brackets referring to the underscore ID field that should be given. Otherwise, if you leave that, it will be giving you an error. Okay, so this is with the read operation. And coming to update, you can also use with update operation. So update field value, that is this I am going to update. So this field and value, it will be getting update wherever present, right? In a particular collection, if you have more than one document with this field and value, all the documents will be updated with the set field, dollar set. Dollar set field 2 comma value 2, this will be settled. So here the field 1 will be updated with this field 2 and value will be changed to value 2. So this is updation of multiple documents. So whenever you find this particular field and value for the particular collection, wherever present, whichever in whichever document it is present, everything will get replaced, okay, with the new value, okay. And if assume that you have three or more documents with the same value, field and value, and I want all the three to be changed or to be updated. So in that case, I have to set multi to be true. Okay. So if you set multi to be true, all the multiple documents with this particular criteria will be updated, right? If I want to set only one particular value or only one particular document to be changed, in that case, you can avoid this. You need not give multi equal to true, right? So this is how you will update. And how to remove a field? Remove a field will be by means of unset. Okay, so you need to have this update method, update which field and value, followed by unset that particular field with one. Okay, I am going to remove that particular field. So this unset operation or this unset keyword will remove a field from that particular collection or document. Okay, and to replace all field value pairs, we can get in with collection dot update individual fields along with its value separated by comma. Right, so you have the updation over all the fields. Say for example, I have three fields in my student database. I need to update all the three fields. So in that case, you can get in with field colon value, comma, next field, comma, next field. So in this way, you can replace all the field values, right? And these are the update operation. And how to remove the records? So assume that I have to remove the records or the document only with a specific value. So in that case, you can have remove of field colon value. If I want to remove only first document, you need not remove the entire documents which matches with the field and value. I want to remove only the first document which matches with this field value. So in that case, I have to set the second parameter to be true, right? So if you set this to be true, it means that the first document that is given will be removed from that particular collection, right? So I hope you are aware of the CRUD operations in MongoDB, and we have executed with the normal create, update, insert operations. And this is only with the command line interface. And I have given you only a snapshot of the basic commands which you can work or try in with the MongoDB. And you can explore the commands and you can try with the MongoDB shell what we have seen so far. I have given just a few examples for each and every commands. You can try with more options. Say for example, for find, you have many, many varieties or flavors with where classes and all. So you can try with each and everything. You can explore yourself in each and every CRUD operations available for your MongoDB. Interested participants, you can get in with your MongoDB Compass for getting graphical user oriented interfaces.